right now, at this very moment, you have a virus controlling your brain. Just kidding. Well, kind of. Hello again, Julia here for DNews. Fun fact, our DNA contains a lot of virus DNA, over 100,000 pieces of it. Over 8% of our DNA is made up of so-called endogenous retroviruses, and a recent study by Lund University in Sweden indicates that just such a virus might be responsible for our super-powered Homo sapien brains. This study found that when these virus DNA bits are activated, they also activate nearby genes, meaning old viruses control our brains. Well, that there are some old viruses in our DNA that control when certain genes get switched on and off. The researchers say this suggests that retroviruses have played an important role in the development of a complex brain. Perhaps they're just one of the reasons brain cells are so complicated and versatile, giving humans the evolutionary advantage of intelligence. So, how did viruses get in our DNA? Well, you can think of them like fossils. Once upon a time, millions of years ago, one of our ancestors got a virus. Maybe a cold, maybe something else. Back then, the virus was just a normal retrovirus hanging out in the host cell. What makes retroviruses unique is how they reproduce. Retroviruses carry their genetic material in RNA. To make more copies of itself, it makes a DNA copy of its genes and inserts it into the host DNA. The host cell then reads the DNA with the viral insert and is tricked into making more copies of the virus. But by a stroke of luck, this particular virus happened to infect a sperm or an egg cell. Then when the baby developed from that cell, it carried the virus DNA in every cell of its body, and when it in turn reproduced, passed that bit of DNA onto its baby, and so on and so forth for millions of years. These viral bits of DNA become so well integrated into the host DNA, they become almost harmless. The viruses mutate to the point where they can't even function. They lose their ability to break out of a new cell and infect a new one. And eventually, they can only make copies of themselves, which get inserted back into the host cell. Multiple copies of the virus gene can wind up strewn throughout our entire genome. Since this has been going on for quite a while, humans and other animals have defenses against these DNA intruders, proteins that keep the virus from replicating. It's thought that most of the time, this bit of virus DNA in our genome doesn't do anything, so they become what scientists consider junk DNA. While most of these viral fossils are just DNA duds, sometimes they're harmful. They've been linked to brain disorders like schizophrenia, and even might cause certain cancers. But sometimes, they're kind of good. Some domesticated viral DNA functions like a gene regulator. They can tell which genes to turn on and off and when. On occasion, the virus DNA is hijacked and put to good use. We owe a lot of our success to virus DNA, and when I say our, I mean mammals. On at least 6 different occasions, virus DNA led to the development of placentas in various mammalian species, a huge evolutionary step. This viral protein called syncytin used to help host cells bind together so a virus could spread more easily. Now, this protein is responsible for the lining in the placenta that helps nutrient exchange between mother and developing fetus, and protects the fetus from the mom's immune system. Studies show that these viral genes matter a whole lot. When they're turned off in mice, embryos don't survive. So we're a little bit viral. That's kind of cool. And researchers think this latest study could lead to more research on genetic links in certain diseases of the brain. Most of the research on genetic factors for disease focus on just about 2% of the human genome. Adding the possibility of a viral-related genetic link opens up a whole new range of possibilities for scientists. So what do you think of our viral inheritance? Cool? Weird? Maybe both? Sound off in the comments below, and for more cool and weird science, check out DNews every day.